In this video, I want to talk about highly persistent time series, and then I want to go on to explain how we can actually combat this. So we've already spoken about a very highly persistent time series. An example is a random walk. So I have xt is equal to xt minus 1 plus some error et, where, as always, et is iid with a mean of 0 and a variance of sigma squared. So let's say I'm at time t and I want to predict the value of x at some period in the future. So let's say I want to predict the value of xt plus h, where h is some positive integer. Okay, so I could back substitute in for xt plus h and I would find that it was equal to xt plus epsilon t plus 1 plus epsilon t plus 2 all the way up to epsilon t plus h. Okay, so how could I use xt to come up with a prediction for xt plus h? Well, that's easy. All we need to do is we just need to take the expectation of xt plus h at time t. So at time t, we have a value of xt already. So just applying the expectations operator to both sides of this, I find that on the right-hand side, all I'm left with is xt, because all of these error terms here at time t are expected to be zero. Okay, so what does this show? Well, it shows that no matter how far in the future xt plus h is, then the best prediction I have for xt plus h at time t is just the value of the series at that particular time. And that's very indicative of the fact that we have a very highly persistent time series. And another way we could have shown this a bit more correctly would be to look at the correlation between xt plus h and xt. And in contrast to the circumstance where we have weakly dependent time series or series which aren't highly persistent, the correlation would tend to 1 as h goes to infinity rather than the correlation tending to 0 as we require it. So this time series is very much not weakly dependent. And it's this fact which poses the most significant problems in regression, because when series aren't weakly dependent, that means that we cannot use normal sort of central limit theorems and law of large numbers for asymptotic inference. So we really shouldn't be including very highly persistent time series in linear regression. Okay, so how can we actually deal with this? Well, one thing is, if we notice xt up here, what would happen if I was to take xt minus 1 over to the other side? If I do that down in the bottom here, we would find that xt minus xt minus 1 would be equal to epsilon t. And this epsilon t, by definition, is iid with a mean of 0 and a variance of sigma squared. So this epsilon t very much is weakly dependent. And furthermore, I can write this a bit more neatly, the change in xt is equal to epsilon t. So even though the time series xt, or the process xt, followed a random walk, which was highly persistent, the change in xt is not highly persistent. It is weakly dependent, and we can use the change in xt in any regression without any problems. So when a time series has the property that it is highly persistent in level and similarly not weakly dependent in level, and when I take the first difference that is not highly persistent and it by logic it's not weakly dependent, that is a series which we refer to as an I1 process, or integrated of order 1 process. And this one here stands for the fact that I essentially needed to take the first difference of the process in order for it to be weakly dependent. A I0 process is a process which is already weakly dependent in levels. And similarly, we can define higher order integrated processes. An integrated of order 2 process means that you need to take the difference of the differences in order for that process to be then weakly dependent. So only when you're looking at the differences of the differences is that then a weakly dependent time series. Okay, so you ask yourselves, well, what is the sort of significance of this in econometrics? Well, frequently, especially in macroeconometrics, variables are very frequently I1 and they are sometimes I2. Examples of frequently I1 variables are things like interest rates. Another example might be if we were to look at GDP, because GDP generally tends to be going upwards through time. But then when you look at the change in GDP, it looks like it could be a stationary time series process and weakly dependent. An example of a I2 variable that comes up quite a lot is if you look at the price level. So often it is the case that if you look at the price level and then you take the first difference of the price level, which is essentially the first difference of price is basically the inflation rate, then often it looks like inflation is still itself a non-stationary time series. So then what you need to do is you need to take the first difference of the first difference, or in other words, take the first difference of inflation, and then and only then does the series look like it is a stationary and weakly dependent time series.